Hey guys, welcome back. We are here for 7-1 in our dealing with nets and drawing for visualizing geometry. So I'm going to switch over to what the notes look like, and you should see your essential understanding here that you can represent a 3D object with a two-dimensional figure using special drawings and techniques. We call this a net. So a net is that two-dimensional diagram that we could fold up, kind of quote-unquote fold up, and then get our three-dimensional shape. So these first three problems here to practice, a lot of students struggle with kind of visualizing this sort of thing, so that's why I'm going to use this camera for a moment. So your first shape there, shape number one, is a hexagonal prism. So that means there's a hexagon on this end and a hexagon on this end, and that it can sit flat, and it will have the same shape on both the top and the bottom. Now remember, we're in the three-dimensional plane, so I could turn this shape like this, and it would still be sitting flat. But the thing is, when we set it so the base is on the bottom, the base has to have the same shape on top and the bottom. So I can't say that the base is a rectangle, even though I see rectangles here. But if I sit that rectangle, it does not go straight up. Notice that if I sit on the hexagon, it does go straight up. All my sides travel straight up, as opposed to a pyramid, where a pyramid doesn't go straight up from the base, it goes up to one point. And we'll discuss that in just a second. So we've got our hexagonal pyramid, or our hexagonal prism, our pyramid, and then our triangular prism. So let's see, these are the three shapes that we're working with. So when we look at trying to visualize a net for one of these, and we switch back over. So which of these nets would make sense to match this hexagonal prism? Well, obviously, it's one that is going to involve a hexagon as two of the faces, and then rectangles for all the other faces. The only option here would be option C, that this, of course, has the hexagon on the end. It has rectangles connecting off every side. Now, really, this hexagon could attach to any of these sides that go from the base to the top, but it is perfectly fine there. It's just got to connect to one of them. So now, if we move on to shape number two, our triangular prism. So this is a triangular prism because we have a triangle on bottom, triangle on top, and there are straight rectangular sides to go from the one triangle up to the other triangle. So if I take this apart and I unfold the net, what I see is I have a triangle from the top and the bottom. If I fold it this way, you might be able to see the edges easier. I have a triangle from the top and the bottom, and then I have rectangles that connect the triangles together. So when I fold it up, I see I have that nice prism. But when I unfold it, I see I essentially just have one big rectangle connected with two triangles. So if we pop back over to our notes, that of course then would be shape A. Now it doesn't look exactly the same as mine because again, this triangle could attach to either any three of those sides. Same with this triangle, connect to any three of those sides, but they are perfectly fine where they are. It's easiest to visualize if you put both triangles attached to the same rectangle, but that's personal preference. Now, of course, through process of elimination, shape three, this pyramid would have to be B. Well, let's look at why that is. So when I have my pyramid right here, when I unfold it, I see that the bottom is a triangle, but then all the sides that go up to the single vertex at the top, they unfold, and you can see I have the triangle from the bottom and the three triangles from the side, and I actually end up with just one big triangle, which is kind of really cool. Or triangular-looking shape, depending on the dimensions of this, it might work out perfect, it might not. But yeah, so that is why shape number three matches B, because that pyramid will have a net that looks like a triangle with three triangles connected to it. So now we are asked, what is a net for the figure below? So I went ahead, and the easiest way to draw nets is always to start with your base. So I went ahead and drew out the base, but the problem is, I've made a mistake here. And I want to know, obviously you're not here that I can ask you, but this is not actually the base of my shape. So I'm going to actually put this in quotations, because the base is always notated to us from what this shape is called, and we can figure that out in prisms based off what shape does it have on both ends. So when I see one shape connected by rectangles to the same shape, then that shape is my base. So really here, this triangle is your base, but for our purposes, we're going to look at the base kind of as at the bottom. So I'm going to use that 7x4 rectangle. I'm actually going to rename this, what to say, bottom. because it is not the base. That's one thing that a lot of people make that mistake. Now, bottom, I'm still going to leave in quotations because we're in the three-dimensional plane. Bottom is kind of relative. So I have this actually 7 wide and 4 to match the 7 and the 4. But then I got to see what shapes come off of this. So hopefully you can still hear me fine. I'm moving over to my smart board, actually. So if I try to look at the edge of 7, so let's say this edge right here, and what's attached to it? Well, there's going to be a triangle coming off of it that the lengths of it are 10 and 10. But the problem is I don't know how tall it is, so I'm really quickly going to actually apply some other math here. I can make a right triangle that would then, if I blow it out like this, I know that this edge is 10, and this would then be 3.5. So my Pythagorean theorem tells me that 10 squared will equal 3.5 squared plus whatever my other side is squared. So I can just take away 3.5 squared from my 10 squared. I know that 10 squared is 100. So I can take away that 3.5 squared. And I get 87.75. I square root that value. And I get that that height is about 9.4. And I just like to know that height so when I'm drawing it. So, because I have a nice grid here, I'm going to go up 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9.4 approximately. Come down here. Come down here. And I will draw the triangle that connects to either the front triangle or that back triangle that you see. Now remember, dimensions are all relative to how you're looking at it. So I'm calling this my front, and I'm calling that back triangle the back. So I'm going to have the same exact triangle coming off the other side of the bottom. So I count 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9.4. Try to put it in the middle there. So I come down here and down there. Now, what I also have then, I've dealt with the triangle on the front, the triangle on the back, but the only faces that I haven't dealt with are this right face and the left face. Now, we know that they're identical to each other, and we know that they're both 10 by 4. I have this edge of 4 already dealt with right here, so I just need to come off of it 10. So I just go 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, up the 4, and then back to the 10. And I would do the same thing on the other side. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, and we ran out of space. There's a 4, and back over. And there is the net for that figure. We would see that if I fold all that up together, it would all come back together as that triangular prism. So take a second moving on to your next problem here, and try this on your own before you come back. I'm actually going to cheat a little bit because it's easier for me, being that I'm in the smart software and I have the capability. I am going to use my shape drawing tool to help me with this net. So I'm going to start with a square. Actually, I'm going to start with the bottom of it again, just because it, for me, is easier. So I identify that this bottom, 2x4, that's going to be the first thing that I draw. So here's probably good enough. I'm going to go 2x4, and there's the bottom shape. Now, this gets a little tricky, so make sure that you keep track of what you've already done. I would kind of sketch on your page as you go. So we have dealt with this one, so you can maybe make a mark there. Tell yourself we've done that. So I'm going to connect the squares to it. I'm going to say that I unfold the square to go above this rectangle and then also below this rectangle. So if I grab a square, then I'm going to have a 2x2 square on this end and a 2x2 square on this end. So that dealt with the front and the back, and sorry that the thicknesses are a little goofed up. So then I've dealt with that side and the front side. So I only have left the left, the right, and the top. So my top, I can connect to either my front or back or left or right. So I'm actually going to make this look a little different than you're probably used to. The left and the right faces are also 2x4 rectangles. So I could draw another 2x4 rectangle for the right and another 2x4 rectangle for the left. But then the top of it is another 2x4 rectangle. I could connect it out here, or I could connect it up. Oop, did not mean to drag that. I could connect it up here, I could connect it over here, and I could connect it down here. Any of those places are all valid for that net. So we see we end up with the squares from the front and the back, and then the four rectangles that wrap around, which those are actually our lateral area as we go. And then we would, of course, label, if I wasn't on a grid sheet, we could label that these squares are 2x2, and the rectangles are all 2x4. In 5, this gets a bit more challenging. So take a moment to think about what this would look like. Again, it's a prism, and we can identify the prism name by what shapes are on the top and bottom. And of course, top and bottom we kind of put in quotations. But here I see that the base shape, the base and the bottom, because my base, again, is always matched on the opposite end, so my base and my bottom are this hexagon. And I'm told that this is 36 wide and 12 at this edge. So that makes this an irregular hexagon. And the problem is that what I have right here is a regular hexagon, so you'll kind of have to go with me and just imagine a little bit. So I'm going to say that these are 12. So let's just go ahead and throw labels there. That's 12, and that's 12. Because remember, in math, it's not what it looks like. It's what you're told that it is. And then this would also be 36 to match. So what I see is that off of that hexagon, there's going to be a rectangle connecting up to the other hexagon off each edge. So I would need a rectangle that is 30 millimeters by 12 millimeters, or 30 millimeters by 36 millimeters. So I would have a rectangle connected to each of those. So let's just approximate that, three of those, maybe approximately. And I'm actually going to cheat some more since I'm in my smart board. I'm going to clone this. And then this is going to get challenging because the diagonal. So let's approximate here. Now I have to rotate. Now the thing that we're going to have to remember is that other hexagon. You can't forget to bring that other hexagon into play. So I connect rectangles off that side. Close enough. And then I can clone that and take it to each of the other sides. We know those are parallel, so that works out nice. I clone this and I can rotate it. And if I clone it again, I know it's parallel to that other opposite side. Last thing we gotta do, I'm gonna try to grab my rectangle. Or sorry, my hexagon. I'm gonna clone that guy. This could connect up here or to any of these other sides. Might as well drop it here just for fun. So we can see that that would fold back up. All the rectangles would be the vertical sides, and the other hexagon would be my other top. So then when we get into solving the surface area of these objects, especially with hexagons, and you should have learned this in 8th grade, we would break this up into triangles, and then we would deal with the hexagon based off the triangles that we can form. So, isometric drawings. A lot of people struggle with isometric drawings if you are not a good visual learner or a kind of artistic in a view, because you have to be able to, on two-dimensional space, view a three-dimensional object. So that's really kind of awkward to think about. But you can see this is supposed to look like a filing cabinet. So if you were looking in the real world at a filing cabinet, you would see the front of it, the right of it, and the top of it at the same time, but then you couldn't see the back of it, the bottom of it, or the left of it because of your perspective. And that you can look at all kinds of different 3D images and realize that they could be represented on isometric dot paper. So we're going to try this on our own for a couple of different things. So try this out, then come back once you think you have this all figured out. I'm going to cheat just so I can have some nice straight lines. I'm going to use my line tool. So I'm going to start with this top block. And to start with that top block, I'm just going to make that block by connecting these four as well as I can. And then that's the top of the top block, so I need to give it some height. So I draw verticals to give it height. And where the block bottom is, I would draw just like that. So now I've got one block. It's not perfect, but it's as good as I can do right now. And then I will come up, we notice that that's actually too tall. So I'm going to make this too tall. Probably in a bad spot. I'm going to shift that just a little bit. This is actually easier paper and pencil than it is. Actually, speaking of which, let's just do that. If we flip back over to me, actually, I'll do paper pencil for the other drawings. I'll go ahead and finish this one. I started this, I might as well finish it. And then this comes off to the side. Start to see that in a second. It comes forward. And you never want to look through the shape, so I should not have actually drawn that one, because that would be me looking through the shape, and I do not have Superman powers. So be careful that sometimes you have to go back and erase lines when you realize you've drawn too much. And this also comes off to the right, and as we add a little bit more in, we can see it getting more three-dimensional. This line also I should not have drawn, because I come off to the side here, and then I come down, and I come over, and up, and then I can represent the top of that block. So you see, you gotta get kind of artsy here to get that perspective, but at this point you should be able to see, it should look in perspective, that you've got the top block here, and this left block, and then the bottom, or the right block, and that we would not be able to actually see the bottom block under this one. Because we don't see it in this image, we don't draw anything in our isometric paper for it. So I'm going to flip cameras around for just a second, go ahead and try number 6, see if you can set up an isometric drawing for that on your own. I've got that, my actual paper pencil here, and I am legitimately going to use a pencil. I always suggest using a pencil or a mat so you can go back and erase. Send a little bit more light here. Not much. You can always skip ahead in my videos too, by the way. So again, I start at the top and work down from there, only drawing the edges that I can see. So I'm going to start really at this top corner. So if I just choose a corner and draw the top of that box, since we can see the whole top of that box. Then, draw a vertical to give it some height. So that was this line, and this line, and these three verticals. So then I come across, and I see I've made a block now. I can keep drawing my verticals, then draw another. This isn't really horizontal, but in real life it would be horizontal. And now I've shown that two-stack, but as I see, I actually should not have just drawn that line, because if I come up here, I cannot see this line. It does not exist. It's there, but I can't see it, because I can't look through things. So I'm going to erase that. I see the top of the next block, so I actually need to come forward, and then across. I then see this face of it, that's what I'm going to draw now, with those lines. I see this left face of it, so I'm going to draw that right here. I have this block at the bottom, I'm going to go ahead and draw the top of it, so I have to come out. This left face of that bottom block is right here. This front face, I guess you could say, it's kind of hard to talk about perspective, is right here. This block, I now draw right here. And then I've got two coming out this way, so I can draw one and two, draw the divider for it.
one and two blocks. I've got to draw the vertical so I can see this face that I just completed right here is this face. And then I just draw all my lines. So hopefully you are getting something like that. And in 7, it's the same basic idea. You just have to make sure you're only drawing lines that you can actually view. So, to do one differently, please try 7 on your own if you haven't tried it on your own. But to do it differently, I am going to do this one starting at the bottom. So I'm going to start at this block right here. So I will draw just one face of it, and that face, because of how I've drawn it, is this face. So now I'm going to go ahead and draw the top connected to it. And then the forward-facing face. And now I see coming off of it, I've only drawn the edges that I see, these four on the top, the three verticals, and the two at the bottom. So then I go up two more blocks above it. And it's hard if you try to draw too much at one time, so you might want to finish faces as you go. And then I can see that I can't draw this line. I was about to draw that line, but I don't see that line because that would be right here. I do see a line coming off of this. So to draw that line, I would do this. And draw that other face. I see this front edge. Then I'm going to move up and draw the other edge. And I see there's a block sitting on top of that. So I keep drawing those verticals. Give that separation between the blocks, and I can see the top of that block, so I go ahead and draw that top. And the reason I want to draw those to catch up is to compare with this level. So I've got two layers here, I've got three layers here, but I need to finish that layer, and I can see, so this face is this face right here, and I finish this block off, then I do the block beside it, I draw the front face of that, I draw up down to the next one, it comes out, actually, and I can see this, and I actually come out one more, and that's due to this block right here, come over, come back to meet it, draw that front edge, and that is everything from that drawing. So hopefully isometric drawings are making a little bit more sense for you. You just gotta take it one edge at a time, and just make sure that you just work slowly and carefully. So now we're gonna talk about orthographic. So we did 6, 7. Orthographic drawings are a great way to represent our 3D shapes. It is taking the isometric drawing and turning it into a two-dimensional drawing based off perspective. So whether it would be the front view or the right view or the top view, and those are normally the three different views that we take for this. Sorry, I'm moving back to my smart board, flipping my mic. So if I wanted to do a front view of this, I see that it's about 3 tall, but it's got a cube on the front. And a cube at the top. So it's probably something like that, because this face right here corresponds with that face right here. Now if I want to do a right draw, I think about looking in from this angle, well, I would see these two, this one sitting on top of it, and then that one. So I'm going to start with a little guy, actually. Then, beside that, we see a rectangle that's too tall, and then on top of that, I would see another square. Make sure that you have these edges, because that's what would show you that one is further away than the other. These two squares are the same distance away, but this is actually closer to us. And then a top view drawing of this would, I would see this top, and that top. So, I'd see that top, and then two more, and then one one beside this, which actually, this would be the lowest, this would be the next one up, and this would be the highest. So that is an orthographic view for that one. I believe that knowing the orthographic views, you should be okay to draw your front, top, and right. So go ahead and try 8 and 9, if you have not yet. And I will do them really quickly and show you the answers. So those are going to be front, right, and top. So my front drawing, they're saying that the front face is now this face. I would see that face, and that face, and that face. So literally, we could just... That could be my orthographic for the front. The right view, I'd be looking from this perspective. So I would see everything here. So that could work. And my top view, I would just see this, that, and that. So again, I can pretty much just easily do that as a top view. So I'm not even going to do number 9. I believe that you guys should have a pretty good hold on this at this point. So if you have any other questions, comments, or concerns on 7-1, please let me know. But aside from that, I will just see you guys later.